already gave my name, so I don't need to say that. And as she said, I don't use social media. I never have, even when there was Black Planet and stuff like that. Can everybody hear me? Can you hear me? Okay, cool. Yeah, so are we good?
Yeah.
All right, cool. Yeah, sorry, my end keeps saying mute. But yeah, so Katie and Delaney asked me to talk about some things that I've found in my studies of R&B and Neo Soul, and what I've been doing with it in the classroom. A lot of what I've been doing has come out of my own experiences with music theory. I was primarily classically trained with regard to theory, at least, but I didn't grow up around classical music. It was just something I kind of fell into. So I thought theory was really interesting, and I kind of went from there. Yeah, I did not expect to be where I am right now, but I'm very grateful for that. One thing that I did notice over time with learning theory was that I felt like I was good at it, but I was only good at it with one genre of music. I was only good at it really with classical theory. I went to Howard University for my undergraduate studies, and I would go to classes, pass all my theory tests, everything was great. And I started to notice when I walked around the building, if you know Howard University's music program, you know they have a really stellar jazz program with the jazz voice, with Sassy, Afro Blue, and the jazz band, gospel choir, a lot of these groups that they're just really great. So I would notice that when I would walk around the practice rooms or just do really anything outside of classical music, I couldn't figure out what was going on. And I could do all these chord progressions and figure out all these expansions and things like that in classical notation. But when it came to something like a Jill Scott song, and then I would try to play it, it didn't line up. And one of the things that I had to realize is that I'm trying to fit it into a model as opposed to actually looking at it on its own terms. And that's kind of something I'm going to advocate for in this talk, and also towards the end, is the idea that when we look at something like post-tonal music, we look at it on its own terms. We know there's probably a shared language, it's probably using pitch class integers, things like that, but we don't go into it expecting to see 5-1 like we do in classical music. We don't go into it expecting to see sort of like cadential structures and things like that. So when we do it, when we analyze that type of music, we often look at it as like contextual analysis. And what I would advocate for is when we're looking at tonal music, especially tonal music outside of the common practice classical tradition, is that we look at it through that lens. First and foremost, to not look at what it's supposed to do, but just look at what it is doing. And don't look at it as necessarily a deviation. If it was some type of deviation, like a tritone substitution or anything else like that, that's great. But yeah, that was my experience with theory, and I had to start expanding my ear a little bit. And last little story before I get into more some examples that we're going to talk about today. I remember walking down the hallway my senior year at Howard, and it was a pianist. Some of you might know her music, Kayla Waters, and she was just practicing. I think she was practicing Chopin, but I knew she was doing R&B, neo-soul types of piano playing. So one day I just asked her, I'm trying to get into Jill Scott's music, and I couldn't figure out what was actually going on, and I put it in front of her, and mind you, I could do this with a symphony or something, and within 30 seconds, she had the entire progression, and I mean, I was working on that thing for like a week, and I just couldn't get it. So yeah, that's been my journey over, I'll say, like the last 11 years now. I finished Howard in 2010, so yeah, just trying to make sure I do that. I'm going to try to make sure I go through it, not too quickly, but quick enough so if there are questions, we can just have a discussion about a lot of these things, about what you have seen with regard to your own experience with music theory. But yeah, so let me share my screen so you can see this. Hopefully it shares the sound too. We can all see this? Great. All right. So All right, so just a few acknowledgments, Delaney and Katie for forcing me to do this. In the Classically Black podcast, they superstars now. My best friend Ariel, she's a program coordinator at the Kennedy Center, and she was one of the first people to really push me when I was at Howard to really branch outside of my thinking. My iPod was probably 95% classical music, and I still like it. I'm never gonna stop liking classical music, but really to expand my thinking about what I was doing. Black culture, just because. And anybody trying to uplift black culture with no strings attached. So the one thing that I want to really go over is this concept. We call it the phrase model. I've seen it also being expressed as what they call the idealized model. And this is kind of what we look to for tonal music to kind of embody. There's nothing wrong with tonal music doing this sort of thing. It actually sounds really nice. You always hear people say 1-4-5-1, 1-2-5-1. Is that sort of model where we have a tonic chord? Stuck
open the door.
Somebody's muted. But yeah, so we have this sort of model that we normally think tonal music embodies. And as I said, plenty of good pieces of music that I like. Let me not just say good music, pieces of music that I like that are tonal, they do this. I would probably say most tonal pieces do this. Not all, not the vast majority, but I would say they're probably the majority, at least over 50% of tonal music does this. And the problem with this sort of thing is that we learn this model and we look to see if things are going to do this a lot of times. I'm not going to say all the time, but a lot of times we look to see if music is going to sort of embody this 1-5-1 sort of framework. It's not saying a piece of music is only going to have three chords, but we're saying like these are the most important chords, I guess you could say. The tonal trajectory of the piece gives you a one chord if I'm in the key of C. And then after that, we expect to hear something like that. And if you think that this isn't a thing, if you think that it hasn't been part of your experiences, think about the way we name cadences. Think about the way you analyze phrases. The way we analyze, if it stops on the 5, what do we call it? A half cadence, because the phrase model wasn't completed. If it is completed, you call it authentic because it completed that entire thing. It did 5-1. Evaded cadence is a deceptive cadence. That 5 didn't go to 1. So this sort of thing kind of embodies like a spirit of what happens in classical music or a lot of common practice music or some other tonal music. But again, there's a lot of music out there that doesn't do this. And the music that I'm going to look at today, one of the things or a few of the things that I've noticed about these things have or these pieces, they don't necessarily have a 5-1 relationship always attached to it. Some of them will, and I'm going to start off with a few that actually do this. But then after that, slowly but surely, you're going to see me move outside of that into musics that don't necessarily have 1-5, or it might do 1-5 if it's in a minor key. And that's something we've been taught in theory classes. Normally you don't ever talk about a minor 5 chord. So if I were in the key of C minor, we expect to hear, or, and we raise that leading tone. So we're always told to do these things in order to make the progression work. So one of the progressions that I've seen, or at least one of the sorts of like tonal trajectories that I've seen within neo soul and R&B, is instead of going 1-4, it seems that the destination, we can say like a long-term destination of the music, is to get to 4. And we might call that like a plagal motion. That's something that comes up a lot in gospel. That's something that comes about a lot in neo soul and R&B. This progression from 1-4 that's filled in. And it's not saying that everything between 1-4 is not important. We know the saying, small hinges swing big doors. It's not just about the big sort of structures. It's about what goes on in the middle of that. So we're not just listening for 1-5 or 1-4 or something like that. We're listening for everything that's happening and how we kind of manipulate that structure. And then the second one that I'm really going to get into is the idea of not just moving 1-5 or even 1-4, but moving within thirds. So using the structure of an actual triad or seventh chord or anything like that, because we think of tonal music, we think of tertian-based structures. That's how we build chords. So we build chords from the bottom to the top, and we have like a C major triad, C, B, G. squares. If we add a seven, we add another third. If we add a nine, we keep adding thirds. You add a 13 or anything else like that, an 11. You just keep adding thirds above the base. So what if instead of looking at the phrase model as this sort of structure that we want to have in our music, what if we look at just moving within thirds, using the structure of the actual chord as our model? So moving, instead of saying we're going to go from C to G, saying we're going to go downward, C to A, to F, to D, and have that just be our progression. Or maybe even moving in seconds, using upper extensions. That's another part of neo soul and R&B, is not just sticking with seventh chords. And this is the last thing I'll say before I get into the first example, is that when we think of tonal music and we think of, for instance, inversions, we have inversions for triads and seventh chords. But if most of the music uses nine chords, 11 chords, 13s, sharp 13s, things like that, sharp 11 chords, what happens when you invert that? We don't have a 4-2 name for that. We don't have like a 6-5 inversion name for that. That doesn't mean that the chord can't be thought of as inverted, but again, we got to be able to expand our thinking when we look at a lot of this stuff. So I'm going to go on to our first example. So this one is a gospel piece, just to get us into it. Again, this one uses what I would say are things from the phrase model. It doesn't end on a one chord. It actually ends on what I would think of as a four, or a sus four chord in the key of B flat major. But yeah, we're in the key of B flat major. And we're just gonna listen to it for a second. There's some things I wanna point out within this before we start to get in the weeds with things that are more chromatic. Or this one actually is chromatic, but it has more tonal features in this. So we'll just listen to it for a second.
Richard, is that playing for you? You can hear it.
Okay, some people are saying they can't hear it, so let me make sure. Is this sharing? I'll do it again. I'm gonna go back again because people are just staring at me. So let's make sure it actually works this time. Just one, at least one person give me a thumbs up if it's working this time.
Yes, Jesus loves me. Oh, yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. For the Bible tells me so.
So that was the harmonization of the hymn "Yes, Jesus Loves Me" by Alan Merville. He's a person who reharmonized it. If you ever get a chance to check out his music, he has a lot of stuff online on YouTube. He has classes that he puts up. Yeah, just go ahead and check that out. So I took this from a video he did on reharmonizations, and one of the things that I want to make sure we point out, there we go. So has kind of the same features that we are normally used to seeing. We have a one chord, and after that we go on to four, then after that we have a five of five. And then that piece is expanded, and then we ultimately end on the four, and then we just kind of leave it there. And a lot of gospel music kind of just leaves that four chord there. But just at the beginning, what we can see is,
yes, Jesus loves me.
Happens after Jesus, he has these patterns.
Loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. For the Bible tells me so.
the first instance we see of that pattern that I put in the light blue, he just puts that in there as like a passing progression where he has the, where he has this. So that progression at 5/6 to 4/6 to 1/6. And then we see him take that and then transpose that into the key of C major. And this is something that happens kind of in gospel and R&B, where not only do you get tonicizations, we've seen fives as fives before, but you have an extended version of something that's actually tonicizing. So no longer are you just taking a four chord, or even let's say we move to flat six or something like that and staying within that key. We go to something that's actually tonicizing it. And then after that, kind of expand that more, but we still get that 4/5/1 motion, even though he's really, we could say he's moving backwards in the phrase model. We can still see this thing happening. So again, I'm not bashing the phrase model. I'm not saying that it doesn't work and that we can't put it in our musics. But as I said, when we get further and further into this talk, we'll see how a piece of music may not do this. And you start to see more and more chromaticism. If we want to talk about this more, I'm happy to come back after this one. So the next song. So this actually happens in gospel. I was going to pull an actual gospel service, but I forgot this actually was in this movie too. So this is a scene from a movie, Don't Be a Menace, where they're kind of parodying church, black churches, but I mean, it's black people made this movie, so it's not like a parody in a bad way. But yeah, so I want you to just listen to it. I'm just going to play the clip, and I want you to listen to how the organist kind of accompanies the preacher while he's going through his talk.
Yes, Jesus.
Didn't they do it? Abraham didn't ask. No question.
Thank you, baby.
That's what God expects from his sheep here at the Greater Ebenezer New Revival Tree of Life. Institutional double rock on the side of the road to Jericho Missionary Baptist Church Zion. And I say Mount Calvary. Y'all don't tell me.
Preach on, Rev.
All right, so we're in the key of B flat, and we can kind of hear the organist. Not only is he using the phrase model to just kind of just play something in the background, but we can also think of this as what we think of as like a functional progression. So we have this. And then after that, we finish that phrase model out, and then he puts a little plagal cadence at the end, and that's something I'll talk about in another talk. With regard to 1/4/1, how that can be a cadence in and of itself, not just that 5/1, but the 1/4/1 being something just closed off by itself. And the reason why I highlighted that is that if we think of the plagal cadence as a tag, we can kind of think of him saying, did I say Mount Calvary, as a little tag. He does this again, like a minute later in the same thing. Listen for it again, how he kind of uses that 1/5/1 progression, then tags on the plagal at the end.
Don't ask how come why come the pastor have to have him a nice house, why come a pastor got to have a nice car, don't ask. I said don't ask. No questions, just give the money.
Brother Dickie, hit the collection plate around on that side. Nigga, get it around on that side.
All right, that smile always gets me at the end. But so yeah, we see this again, this progression still happening. And the interesting thing about this is that it's not just like he's backing him. He's actually following along with his sentence structure. So as he's emphasizing his points, he's putting more and more chromaticism in there. But when he notices he's getting to the end, he gives you a 5/1 cadence as soon as he's finished his idea. And then after that, when he says, just give the money, he puts a little plagal cadence in there. And he's finished. So we can still talk about this stuff within the theory classroom. We can show how not only does it work musically, but how it works with narrative or words or anything else like that, even if it's not part of an actual song. We can also get into homiletics and things like that with regard to how the preacher and the organist interact. So kind of moving through time, I'm going to kind of go back and then back in time and then come forward. So the first example is Anytime, Anyplace, Janet Jackson. So getting into actual R&B. this song has 1, 4, and 5. The entire beginning part, the verse structure is that. And then after that, when you get to the chorus, it basically does the same thing. But I'm just going to play a little bit of it for a second. Once the groove starts, you'll actually hear the 1, 4, 5 being repeated. So one of the first things we teach students is 1, 4, 5, but a lot of times we stay away from examples like this. And I can see kind of why, because it has those upper extensions, but again, it's still 1, 4, and 5. We don't have to necessarily get into what the 9 is, what the 11 is, but I mean, if the student knows what a 7th is, you're just adding those thirds on top of it. So again, we have this progression right here. It's still just, but it just sounds better. Because we add extra notes, we add extra tension notes that we normally think of as dissonances that have to resolve. We could just leave the chord instead of saying, we can add those other tones in there. And it's still fine. Even when I set up the key when I'm teaching, instead of just doing, sometimes I do other progressions or kind of manipulate the progression to get a student, get my students to kind of think outside of that. So again, instead of, I might do something like a, before some type of harmonic dictation. Doesn't matter that it has all these tension notes in it. It's still, it's the same thing. So we just trying to get people to stretch their thinking instead of having them always hear 1, 4, 5 without upper extensions in there. So the next one, let me just make sure. So the song to start. Everybody Loves the Sunshine. So this was this comes from Roy Ayers' album Everybody Loves the Sunshine from 1976. Always sampled. Roy Ayers is frequently sampled in hip hop and R&B. If you've seen Straight Outta Compton, this was in one, I think the opening 10 minutes when they first showed Dr. Dre on his bed. So I'll play a little bit of it just so we can hear the chord progressions. This, every two bars just gives us a different part of the song. So the first part, I'll make sure we can hear that. First and foremost, we got to think of a key. That's sometimes the first thing that we want to be able to do is try to figure out how we can fit things in it. And my hierarchy that I have students sort of look through is to first figure out if things are diatonic. So we try to figure out a chord, try to figure out if all the chord tones work within the key. And then we start to see the sort of structures that we see. So if we see we're in F sharp minor or anything else like that, then we say, okay, if we're moving a third down, minor third down, what do we expect to see within the key? And then once we start to move outside of it, we start to think about tonicizations. Can it be a 5 of something? Can it be a 7 of something? The next step, you probably think, okay, is this borrowed from something? Because this happens a lot in neo-soul and this sort of early soul music from Roy Ayers or his group Ramp, which I'm going to get into next. This idea of a lot of times we think of modal mixture, we think of borrowing from we're in a major key, and then after that we borrow from the minor. We don't normally talk about it being in minor and borrowing from the major, but I mean it happens. If you know the Avengers theme, it's Somebody might say that's maybe Dorian or something like that, but we can think of it as minor one. Getting that major four chord, and then after that, moving on from there. So in this one, we can kind of think of it the same way. If we think of this as being an F sharp minor, then we say, okay, that's a one chord. We normally expect to see a sixth be a D major chord, but what you get instead is that minor D sharp chord. And where does that D sharp minor chord come from? It comes from F sharp major, which is the parallel key. So if we're in F sharp major, we have that chord there. So we have this D sharp minor chord. So we're moving down into a chord that's borrowed from the actual major. It's not a sound that we're normally used to hearing. And then we get to that E minor chord or E sus4. Now, some of you are probably looking at these and asking, what is a sus4? Basically, think of it in this way without going to a book and reading for a week about it. A sus4 just means take out the third and then add the fourth above the bass. It's basically a suspension, which you'll normally think of as a 4-3 suspension, except you aren't resolving that four. Again, tension notes being able to, you can just sit on the tension notes. So instead of saying that this chord has to be like this, or even, we can substitute that A and then put in, or. We can put those substitutions in there. So that's something that we don't talk about really at all in our normal theory studies, is leaving out the third, and for good reason. With a chord, when we have a root, the root gives us our foundation. The next part, the third, gives the chord its identity. That's how we know if the chord is major, if it's minor, anything like that. We know the modality based on its third. But sometimes leaving out the third, we can say it's almost implied based on the other harmonies. And even if we don't know what it is, that ambiguity of the chord actually can give it a little bit more than it would if we just put a third in there. I'm going to go on to the next example. Hopefully this doesn't play. All right, so I'll come back to those if we have time. This next one is from Roy Ayers. It's a group. He didn't perform with them, but RAMP stands for Roy Ayers Music Productions. It was a group. I think the lead singers were women, females. I can't remember their names, which is bad. But this group from 1977, this is their only album. But it kind of has that same feeling of moving between something that is third bass. So I look at this as being in B minor. So if we look at this first harmony, we have this chord here. And then we can go over here. And let's listen to it for a bit and I'll talk about what's happening. Oops. How none of those chords have this third. So again, none of those chords have its third, but we can still. All right, so that sort of idea of leaving things out, leaving the actual, it's not saying it's completely ambiguous, like we're just wallowing and trying to figure out where we are, like listening to Debussy or something like that. We actually can hear the progression moving between something, and that motion, that's why I highlighted that, or highlight to me is gray, but that's because I like gray. So one to six, one to flat six, I guess you can look at it as, but if it's B flat, B major or B minor, just one to six. Actually, let me say that again. If it's B minor, it's one to six. If it's B major, it's one to flat six. Because in B major, you'd have to have a G sharp. But if you lower that to a G natural and you build a major triad, you can say it's borrowed. So we're looking at that one to six motion. I'm highlighting that for good reason. But before I get into that one to six motion, something probably comes up as to what is neo soul. A lot of times I see people online talking about how to make a neo soul beat. What is it? For me, a lot of what we describe as neo soul, that kind of feel, comes largely from a guy named Jay Dilla, who passed away sadly in mid-2000s, I think. Yeah, he had this way of making beats. A lot of times when we when people got technology, they would put things into the electronics that they were using, and they use a form of manipulating those beats or anything else like that called quantizing. And quantizing, all it is making sure everything lines up on the beat. Well, what he did in a nutshell was basically a lot of his music, you can kind of hear it playing behind the beat. Instead of just everything lining up exactly where you think it's supposed to, what he's doing is doing things. A lot of what he was doing was manual. You can see in this picture, he's using the drum machine, using a record player and everything like that. He had extensive jazz knowledge, a lot of R&B knowledge, a lot of records just to be able to sample things from. And what he would do is deliberately kind of play behind a beat. And not only do you hear musicians doing this with regard to just the drummer, you might hear the guitarist doing this, you might hear the bassist doing this. And the effects that you get by doing this, if you're confused about this, listen to the chill hop. A lot of people listen to that while they're studying or anything like that, and you get this sort of like lo-fi sound, lo-fi, low fidelity. It's almost supposed to sound like the quality is lower, like you're listening to a record player or anything like that. I'll play a little bit of his music just to hear it. You kind of hear like the quality is not as, I guess you would say, like clean as another recording. And you can hear how the beat is just slightly behind where it would normally be if everything lined up. If you ever get a chance, check out his music. So that 1-6 motion, I'm going to come back to that with Robert Glasper experiment liftoff. So that 1-6 motion, this was a piece that I tried to analyze for a while, and I have certain arrows in there. I'm going to get into those in a second. So this song, I look at it as being in key of B major. I put it in 5-4 because Robert Glasper plays in 5-4. To me, it sounds like the drummer is playing in regular 4-4. He's playing in the even meter against the 5-4, and they don't really line up until the very end of the song, or really with that turnaround. But a few things in this that I wanted to just make sure we talked about. Let's just listen to it before we get into all the analysis.
Oh yeah. Hello world. Peace and love. I wish you the best. And now for the next. Coming to your mind. Live and direct from the ethers. Now it's all in your speakers. Down to your sneakers.
The progression repeats itself over and over again. Now, again, if we're looking for 1-5 relationships, we're not necessarily going to find it, but we can find certain things in here that are alike. So the first thing, we figure out the key that we're in the first chord, to me sounds like it's the tonic. And if that's the tonic, what we can kind of do is fit everything else within that key. And if it doesn't, then we keep moving to other chords within it, or just trying to figure out how these chords fit together. So if we're in the key of B major, this is, we normally are used to hearing it like that, but he fills it up with the tension. If we hear it, so we can hear this the same way we heard the other piece going from 1-6, which is one of Robert Glasper's movements that I see, or I hear him do a lot. If you watch the movie The Photograph, that soundtrack with Issa Rae and Lakeith Stanfield, he did the soundtrack for that, the score for it. And 1-6 is something that he does a lot in his music. Now, in this case, he's filling it in stepwise, and that's something we're going to come back to at the end as well. This idea of filling in the stepwise progression, which we normally associate with like lament or anything else like that, lament bass. or just some type of chromatic descent, but filling that in a way where it's not necessarily the functional progression you're normally used to seeing. Another thing is, other than just that 1-to-flat-6 motion, you get these 5-1 relationships between chords. So if we look at the third harmony, here's the first one, the second one. The second one, or the third one, we get this A13 sharp 9 chord. That acts as, if we just think about that as an A chord, what is A the 5 of? It's 5 of D. And then we actually go to a chord that basically is a D major chord. And it sounds almost like 5-1 if we listen to it that way. So I'll play those two chords in succession, the A13 and the D13 chord. If we listen to it this way. And then that D13 chord, D is a 5 of what? It's a 5 of G. So we can hear. So that's almost like a little circle progression that he inserts in there in order to be able to get to the G chord. I wouldn't be surprised if he did this kind of just by accident, just playing it and figuring out a way to get to the G chord without really messing with the rest of the progression. So. And then the last part of it that I'll get into with this piece is when you see this F minor, B flat, C minor that comes out of nowhere. We're in the key of B major. Even if we're in the key of B minor, we wouldn't expect to see those notes. But seeing that F minor chord, the way he voices it, ignore my spelling of the chord in the right hand. I should have put flats on there. Made that A flat, C, E flat instead of G sharp, B sharp, D sharp. People who don't like accidentals, forgive me. But you get this F minor chord there. And one thing I didn't put in here was the B flat on that second chord in the second measure. So that B flat is kind of bent into the next note, which is C. So what you get really is. And then we get to the. So we can kind of see him doing the same thing in a key that's just a half step above where he is. So he starts in B major, going to flat 6. Now he's in C minor. And then after that, you get this chord here, which is basically we can kind of think of as a flat 6. Some people may disagree with that, but I'm hearing that as mainly a function of 1-to-flat-6, same way he does it in the main part of the song, not the turnaround at the end. So for a while, I kept trying to figure out what was he doing with that A flat 13 chord or the sus 4 and trying to make sense of that. Another chord that he leaves the third out of, and I kept looking for that. Again, this is my advice to you, and I had to take my own advice. Don't look for something that exists within it. Kind of, you know, let the music speak for itself. So I'm going to get into the next one. So this is Floor Tree, Say Yes. Before I talk about it, same thing. Let's just listen to it and kind of see what's going on.
See, I've been watching you for a while, your smiling style. Wanna know if I can be with you for the night, alright?
Great. So we have this span from G minor to D flat major. So we're trying to figure out how do we fill that in. One way we could look at that, if we just play the roots of each of those chords, it sounds like what we might think of as a whole tone scale or a whole tone, a subset of like a whole tone collection. If we think of, so he's using that and harmonizing that. That's another thing that neo-soul artists do is that they take certain progressions, they take certain structures, maybe take a major scale, take a pentatonic scale. Maybe we can do this at the end. Take a scale or some type of stepwise progression and then fill it in a way where it doesn't necessarily fit what you think it's supposed to fit in. Looking at notes as like target notes or looking at a note as part of a chord. So that G doesn't have to be related to something in the key of D flat major. It can just be what it is. And because if we know we're going to harmonize that, let's say we really want to harmonize the C or the B flat. Those notes work in the key, the upper two notes of that G minor 11 chord. So we get the. So if we just thought about it, that works in the key. The upper voice works in the key of D flat major. But if we look at everything, we don't have to necessarily say, okay, that C, what fits in the key of A flat? Start to think about things that are outside of the key of A flat. So we know a C can be anything else in any other chord. It can be the tonic to a C major chord. It can be the third of a A flat major chord. It can be the third of an A minor chord. Really allowing students to really stretch their thinking. And I'll say this before I get into the next thing. A lot, I have a nephew, he's 1 year old and a little over one, but I don't like saying 14 months because that sounds weird. So one thing I've noticed about him, just looking at how he's learning things, and I've taught kids before, looking at what they do, free play, things like that. Most of what they learn is just like them trying things. You put them in the corner with some toys, they're just doing that. They observe a lot, they're just doing that. A lot of times when we teach theory or we teach, a lot of times we teach theory, a lot of other things, I'm just talking about theory today, is we teach it from the standpoint of, here's what you shouldn't do. So when you learn about chords and you learn how to move between chords and what chords to use, you learn every chord not to use, every voicing to not use, every parallel motion to not do, rather than just exploring something. Because a lot of what we see in music today is people just not doing those things. Maybe they knew the rules and they broke them, or these models and they broke them, but a lot of it is just people exploring these things. So an equal balance, and I can't say I have the exact answer, but this is something I've constantly been playing with, is this idea of, hey, presenting students with certain things like this and then allowing them to sort of just move around. So yes, I'm going to teach voice leading. I'm going to make sure they know what that stuff is, because for me, voice leading is a predecessor to, or it's like a step before learning how to orchestrate. So for me, I make sure they learn how to do that. But a lot of it is, if I'm playing something or they give me a wrong answer, if I ask for a certain chord, I'll play it for them and I'll say, hey, here's how it sounds. Here's why it didn't work the way I asked for, but maybe it could work in another progression that you do. Here's another example of us moving. This is her, so kind of moving into the last 10 years, I guess. This is her from her album, I Used to Know Her. I don't know if that's supposed to have dots in the actual title, but yeah, this is from the Prelude 2018 album. I'll play a little bit of it just so we can talk about
it. Please, allow me to show you something.
Somebody tell me the answers. Me and you isn't the answer. Me and you isn't. Maybe I'm telling myself that, but there ain't nothing that'll change that. What good would it be if I knew how you felt about me? Yeah. It could've been right, but I was wrong. Only think about you and I'm alone. Part of me that cared is just gone, and I know that I can't get caught up. We could've been, and we try to pretend every now and again.
Sorry. So this one, another song, we have these upper extensions on the chords. We have these tension notes in there, except the first chord that we hear doesn't sound like an actual tonic. It doesn't sound like it's probably the foundation of the music. Not even just looking for 5-1, it doesn't really sound like that as much. So the first chord that you get at the very beginning, and then you rest into that C sharp minor 9 chord. So we get that D sharp minor 11 going to the D 9 chord. We can try to think of what is that flat 2 doing going to 1. And normally we learn flat 2 as a Neapolitan, and the Neapolitan is a predominant, and the predominant is supposed to be before the dominant, hence the name pre. But we also know in popular music and jazz and a lot of other musics and gospel, a lot of these genres, the flat 2, especially when you add the 7th or you add these upper extensions, it can function as a tritone substitution. So what you do is, instead of going to 5, that should be, or not should be, but normally you'd expect to see 2-5-1. But if we substitute the G sharp, which is our 5 in the key of C sharp minor, with the tritone away, we get D. So that's where we get that progression. So this is kind of what we would think of as a functional progression, whether it's jazz or gospel or anything else like that. We have this motion that's stepwise downward from that D sharp to the C sharp. And we can think about that flat two as functioning in that way. And then we get this section that goes from C sharp to A major to F sharp minor. So if we think about it, so if we think of that motion down, third bass motion that I talked about at the beginning, so not necessarily looking for the five. In this case, we got the third bass motion from C sharp, or the C sharp, the one, we go to the six, we go to the four. Reason why I'm pointing this out is that this actually comes up in some other musics where we see this third bass motion, particularly the third bass motion that descends from one going to four, and four being sort of like a destination. And I know it ends on that E9 sus4 chord, but again, if we think about the actual trajectory of this line from just that middle part, I'm not gonna try to convince you that it's actually doing this just one to four, but we can kind of hear it being that. Another song that kind of descends from one to four is Summer Walker's Playing Games. I heard this on a ride with my sister by accident, but it's a good song. I'll play a little bit of it so we can hear it.
Whip, body, crib, got it, job on it.
Great, now play more if we have time. But we start off with this chord at the beginning. Minor five. Again, we don't normally talk about minor five, but that chord can work. Pharrell uses that chord a lot too. So we have this. Then the G major, or the nine. And the reason why I put the notes in the gray, those notes, it might jump out at you and say, okay, why is that in the song? And I'll play more of the song so we can hear it. But that B7 with the flat nine, you got the D sharp on the bottom. You might think, okay, why is that in there? One, it just sounds good. But functionally, what can we look at it as doing? So I put at the bottom, we could look at that one as a B dominant seven chord, basically with a flat nine. We could look at it that way. So when we normally hear that chord, what do we expect it to do? We expect it to go to E. In this case, E doesn't come for another chord. We get a G major chord in the middle of that. But if we think about the relationship between G major and E minor, this is London on the track that did this production. He does, I think, a few others on the album. So if we think about the relationship between G major and E minor, they are related by the same key signature. They're both related relative major and minor keys. That's one way we could think of him being able to use that B dominant seven chord before that G major. But another way we can kind of conceive of it is if we take away the B for a second, that's why I put in parentheses, and we just look at D sharp, F sharp, A, C, because a flat nine chord on a dominant flat nine chord can also be thought of as the upper four notes being as a fully diminished seven chord. And if we remember fully diminished seven chords, they basically have four potential leading tones. This is a symmetrical harmony. So F sharp could be a leading tone. A could be the leading tone. C can be a potential leading tone. When I say leading tone, and a fully diminished seven chord could be a potential root. So in this case, we could look at it, if we spell it D sharp, F sharp, A, C, we could think of that D sharp, we could think of one of those tones as resolving to the G major chord. So if we respell that, take away the B and respell it. So instead of doing, take away the B and respell it and put the D sharp as an E flat, that works to get us there. And then you can use the same harmony to actually do it the so-called proper way to get you in the E minor. And what I'm going to do is play the track a little bit more so you can hear how he kind of just throws these things in there. And the thing is, this doesn't happen every single time you hear this progression in the song. Sometimes he throws it in there, sometimes he doesn't. So the idea is that you get, and then you get this progression. So just putting those things in there to kind of give the piece a little bit more flavor. Let's listen to it again.
bought it, crib, got it, job on it. Did I ever ask you to take me to go shopping in Paris or go sailing overseas and just drape me in Gucci, no? All I ever asked was you to pick up the phone when you alone. All I ever asked was you to show me some love, kisses and hugs. No, I never had an issue, go to the club with your boys, baby. I never wanted you to stay too long, just wanted you to show me up. So won't you say my name if you claim you want me, it ain't no that.
And it keeps going like that. So again, instead of just sticking with the give you, putting those progressions in there. So it is 1-4. And then at the end, we get this 2-5 motion that doesn't always appear. It certainly doesn't appear at the intro, but you get this. So you do get a 2-5-1. So London on the track maybe opened up a theory book and he said, let me just put 2-5-1 at the end of this on some repetitions. But it's something that works. When we take it away, it doesn't sound necessarily incomplete. So you have the, that 4-1 motion does not sound incomplete, but sometimes he is able to put in things that tonicize certain chord tones. Sometimes he puts in something that looks like what we would conceive of as a phrase model, that 2-5-1 relationship. Again, I put it in gray because those don't happen all the time. So the main parts of the song are the one, the minor 5, the 6, and the minor 4. We're going to the next one. This one I just kind of threw in for fun, but it does span the third. You get this F sharp. So we're going from this F sharp minor 9 to this A minor 9. But what you get in effect, instead of just getting that sort of that same sort of sound, so you get that F sharp. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't play it.
They say I'm crazy, the way you got me open, baby.
Yeah, so that F sharp chord, clearly a tonic to me, but just moving through that, we expect to see a G minor chord on 2, really a G diminished chord, but puts in the minor, because if we're an F sharp minor, we expect to see a 2 chord that is diminished, except we're using the 2 from where? From the minor. Or from the major, I'm sorry. If we were in F sharp major, we would probably see a G sharp minor chord. The A minor chord doesn't really make sense as far as a progression from F sharp, because we can't say that that's borrowed from anything. So we can't say that that. And I'm not playing it the way I actually transcribed, because you actually get this. That's what the actual progression is. So this span of another third that we see, just filling in that third with chords that don't necessarily fit within the key, but using those upper extensions to kind of pull you away. And that is really the goal of it, is you don't want to always sound like everything is diatonic, at least in this sort of music. And in a lot of neo-soul, you start to hear these chords with those upper extensions being used that stray far outside the key. Let's go to another one. So this is Janae Aiko's, I forgot I put a lot of examples in. So this is Janae Aiko's The Worst, another song I kind of just fell into, but same thing, filling in the span of a 1-5-4. Except in this case, instead of going C sharp to A to F sharp, you have this stepwise motion between the first 3 chords or the first 2 chords, and then you get to the F sharp minor chord. So I'll play a little bit of it.
Tell me what you say now. Tell me what you say, come again. If you cannot stay down, then you do not have to pretend like there is no way out. I should've never let you in, cause you got me face down. And don't take this personal. You're the worst, you know what you've done to me. And although it hurts, I know I don't need you, but I want.
Somebody's saying she don't need you. She's saying a lot. But with that C sharp minor chord at the beginning, we clearly set up the tonic. And then we'll to that A minor chord there. So again, filling that span of a third. And then going down another third. And sometimes the B major chord appears to get you back there. But again, that big long-term trajectory of trying to fill in that fourth is something that we see happening again in this. And then when we get to the next part, the pre-chorus. Does the same thing with that C sharp going down in third. All right, so this one is one I like. It does the same thing. Now, I'll play a little bit of it just so we can hear it. Entirety, but so at the beginning we can say, okay, this is in C major, and we get this the sound at the end and the last two chords. And then the beginning part we could kind of think of as almost filling in the five chord, that entire beginning, and then we go to four. And somebody might say, okay, maybe the point of the piece is to really get you to one, that G to C motion, instead of one to four that I've been talking about for the last few examples. So we get this. We hear the repetition of that, because that whole beginning measure just sounds to me like a setup for the one, instead of being like something that's a target. And the reason why I say this is that a lot of times when I'm listening to these pieces, I try to look at other performances of it. So I look at a live performance of what's going on. I also do the same thing for my students, and I try to make sure they see, okay, how is this thing being changed? So this one, we could look at it because he inserts that beginning part. But again, to me, that one to four always stood out. And then he did a performance at the, I think it's the Fonda Theater in LA in 2016. I might be saying that name wrong, but he did a live performance in LA with his group, Robert Glasper Experiment. And just take a listen to it. So in this one, he transposed it up a step. So instead of being in, you still get one to minor four, just like he did with C major going to F minor. Except now he gives you it a half step up in C sharp major. So instead of again, we get. But another interesting thing he does is he employs more mixture than just saying, okay, I'm gonna put in a four. He gives you an A major triad right after the one, and then he switches back into where it's supposed to be, which is an A sharp minor chord in the key of C sharp. And then after that, we go back into the four to give us that bigger trajectory of going one downwards to four. So we have this, and then we switch that around and give us ourselves. So that motion between that is the same thing that he would have done. But now he's filling it in. Instead of just 1 to 4, we get 1 flat 6 to regular 6 down to minor 4. All right. And the last couple of things I wanted to talk about is the idea of a chromatic bass. So we've talked about a lot of descending bass lines, but one thing that I've talked to my students about in the past is how do these things reflect the lyrics, or can they be reflective of the lyrics? Normally we associate chromatic descents with like a lament, something sad. That doesn't mean always has to be that, but normally if we hear that sort of thing happening, it's probably gonna be a signal that, at least in the common practice, when we teach it, we call it the lament bass. That's another name we give it. That's something I've taught myself. But looking outside of that tradition, looking just within R&B right now, I'm not even talking about when it happens in Caribbean music, anything else like that. The next couple of examples will give us that sort of framework where we will hear a bass descent. So in this one, we get that opening span of a fourth. So we're in the key of E flat minor, so we get this progression at the beginning, and then after that we the progression starting on 1, going to the 6, going to the 4. Same thing we saw in the last few pieces, just third bass motion that's not heading towards some type of dominant. And then we keep going, and then we see this chromatic descent at the very end before the line repeats. So this part comes in when she's starting to say, you're not the only one, or I'm not the only one. So let's listen to it a little bit.
Thought I told you not to trust these hoes. Say they love you and you know they don't. Say they will, but shit, you know they won't. Yeah, you hear me, you don't feel me though. You are not the only one. 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 Okay, fuck.
All right. I ended it on a good note. That's good. So we're in E flat minor. That C flat in the second to last measure should be a C flat major. So my theory people in here, do not get upset at me. Yeah, that should be a C flat major chord, not C flat minor. But we are at the beginning. And then we get this when she's saying you're not the only one. Because really the lyrics, if you listen to it, it's a lot of basically sad emotions. This is not something that's neutral or anything else like that. So we can kind of think of that last part where she does. And then you get this. So that little descent part, while she's saying you're not the only one, is almost like she's admitting something to herself, but we can have discussions about things like that while we're listening to this sort of music. It's not just, okay, we figure out the chord progression, figure out what's going on. An added part of that is actually figuring out what's going on with the lyrics. We talk about text painting, Schubert, and we go through that, all the leader and everything else like that. This is another example of something where we don't just have to pay attention to music, although that's great. Listen to the groove and everything else like that, but we can also talk about those musical features. Again, while she's saying you're not the only one, to be able to put that. I'm gonna play one more time just to listen to that, and then we'll get into the last piece I'm gonna talk about today. As she's going through it.
Thought I told you not to trust these hoes. Say they love you and you know they don't. Say they will but shit you know they won't. Yeah, you hear me, you don't feel me though. And you are not the only one. You are not the only one.
So again, that sort of that descending line, and them arpeggiating it too. That's another way we can kind of we can think of the producer or the producer and the singer bringing out that line. And the last one I wanted to talk about that does this is Lucky Days Misunderstood. So this is from his album Painted. I put both covers up there because he has one on the extended version, which is the one at the bottom in the yellow or goldenrod or whatever Crayola color that is. He has this the same song he does live in New Orleans, where some of the tones, the ones that you see in parentheses, basically the first harmony and the third harmony. I put a note in parentheses. Sometimes those that appears on the actual record, the second one in a D minor chord, it appears more often in live performances, given whoever is the pianist at the time. So I'll play a little bit of it and then I'll talk about some features of this music.
Together, girl, maybe we're better misunderstood. I've been trying to be clear in my feelings, girl. Maybe we're better misunderstood. I've been overthinking, we really even got a name. We'd be so much better misunderstood.
Misunderstood.
We'd be so much better misunderstood.
Keeps going like that. So the lyrical content of this, just from the title, he's basically he's accepting the fact that, you know, things are not going to be official, things are not going to be great as he wants them to be, but he's happy, almost settling, if you listen to the lyrics. And you might think, okay, he's in a good space, he's not, you know, totally mad, he's not very happy. But to be able to say that, yeah, you're misunderstanding relationship, we could just tell people we're working on or anything else like that, that's not necessarily something that could be perceived as good, something that's positive. And if we look at the bass line, we get this descent from E down to B that goes back up. And we can think of it chromatically, because if we were in E minor, those notes would not all be chromatic with if we take away the E flat. So once we add in a chromatic note, we can kind of think of it as a descending chromatic bass line instead of just a descending line. So we have this line. Normally in classical music, you might hear. That's normally how you'd hear that line if it was in the middle of a mass or something like that. You'd hear it harmonizing that way. But notice how he's able to take that progression instead of doing that, putting in those upper extensions first of all. And the reason why I put that E there is, again, in the live performance, he puts in that. But I'll just play it the regular way first. Get the F sharp when he repeats it. So the first time leaving it out and then putting in the F sharp when we repeat the passage in that E minor 11 kind of gives it that extra thing. So sometimes leaving tones out is something that these artists do at times. So these are just a few of the things that I've noticed when I've been going through the music. One of the troubles that I've had with analyzing this stuff is trying to parse out what is neo-soul, what is R&B, what these things actually are. Because some artists, they flow inside, in and out of what we would normally say, okay, this is an R&B artist. I saw some article talking about John Legend that said he's a neo-soul artist. And I would never classify him as a neo-soul artist, but that's the thing. Somebody will read that and that's going to be the thing that they know. Just the same way someone will read a theory book and that's the, what they will conceive of as music in its entirety, or music theory. So that sort of idea of just trying to figure out what's going on, another extension of what I'm trying to think about with this sort of research or just analyzing these things, is a lot of the songs I've noticed are in minor keys. When we move outside of really the early part of, I would say, like the 80s or 70s, a lot of these love songs that were in soul music, whether it was the Four Tops, the Temptations, Honeycomb, a lot of these bands around that time, Coffee, a lot of these bands that people never really even heard of, or Earth, Wind & Fire, their music, their love songs, their songs about intimacy were always, not always, but a lot of times they were in major. And as we move into this music now, especially neo-soul music, we start to notice that they're in minor keys. And I ask this question to my students because I started to have ideas about it. And I asked them, why is it, like, we were going over a few of these pieces. And I said, why do you think that they put all these pieces in minor keys? If it's supposed to be about intimacy, about bringing people together, doing things like that, why do you think that? One student told me that because they're sinning and they're doing something they're not supposed to do and God is going to be mad at them. But I thought that was weird. But I thought about that a little bit more, and the fact that it is a taboo subject. Sex is a taboo subject. So if we think about it that way, it's not something that even people who are, you know, in the most intimate relationships might talk about really openly. So it, that might be a reason why we put things in minor keys. It's still something I'm playing with, but yeah, the idea that we might associate the modality of it with our feelings towards it. So if it's something that we're not used to or really comfortable talking about, or at least comfortable talking about as openly as it, if we were talking about, hey, where do you want to go for vacation, or where do you want to eat today, or something like that. That's something that you don't really think about that much. If you wanted to talk about that, it'll just ice cream. Great. But if it's something like this, if it's something that's talking about something more sensual, something, again, that, like I said, even people who are in committed long-term relationships don't talk about that openly. It might be that we are, again, associating our disposition towards intimacy and sex with the way we look at the modality. That was another question I asked my students, is how many songs do you know that's about happy things, or about things that you're comfortable with that are in minor keys? A lot of times you think of it as major. Think about all the things we give students to sing when they're growing up, little kids. Most of them are in major keys. And that's a nature versus nurture thing. I don't know if we, I would always say, like, what would happen if you put a bunch of babies in a room and only played minor mode songs or post-tonal music for them? What would happen? Nobody should do that. But it is an interesting idea, like, what people actually think about or conceive of as, like, major and minor, because everybody says major is happy, minor is sad. I teach that sometimes just to get students to hear it in oral skills. But yeah, is minor something that is sad? And is it, if it is it something that is representative, or is this something that people use to be representative of, like, the actual emotions, or like an uncomfortability, or something that's hidden like a veil? So that's where my mind is. Further things that I been trying to do with this, and I'm thinking about doing my students, and this is the last thing I'll talk about, is the idea of not necessarily having them only compose things pencil and paper, because most people leave music schools, music programs, you pay thousands of dollars to learn music, in quotation marks, and no one, I can't think of many programs that have students, like, you leave a program, you can't use GarageBand or FL Studio or something like that. And most a lot of music is composed like that today. Look in the back of a concert hall, there's somebody on a mixer back there probably doing something with the mics and everything else like that. Doesn't mean students have to be experts at it, but taking home a worksheet, and this is something I'm guilty of myself, taking home a worksheet and having them just work on progressions like that instead of actually playing it, actually, like, trying to think of another way to conceive of these harmonies, just putting things down on the piano, or whatever other instrument that they're doing, putting voices together, trying to think about it outside of the realm of, like I said, traditional ways of looking at it. So, like I said, having a homework assignment where we have some chord progressions, having to create a groove or something like that with these chords. So that's something I'm constantly trying to think of. Again, I don't have all the answers. It's something that I'm still growing with and I'm learning from, just being open to the idea of doing that. But yeah, that is the end of what I had to say today. So thank you to everybody for actually showing up to this. That means people actually like theory, or you were forced to come, I don't know. But yeah. There we go.
Hey, thank you, Richard. I don't know.
Oh, wow, there's a lot of people here. Okay. Yeah. I for real thought it was going to be like 10 people. And then I got an email from my professors at Eastman, and I was like, how did they find out? Like, but anyway, I don't mind it. I didn't think it would be. I mean, but that's good. That's good.
Thank you, brother. It was much appreciated today. Much love. Stay blessed from Boston. This was a beautiful talk. I sent you a message in the chat.
Oh, okay. I'll make sure I see that in there.
For sure. For sure. Awesome. Much appreciated. Stay blessed.
Cool. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, sir, this was an excellent lecture. I talk about a lot of these same topics with my students. You struck a lot of chords, quote, pun. I loved it. Maybe we could get together and have some discussions.
Yes. Let me put, because the only online presence I have is an email address. So let me do that. It's probably not going to change. I see Delaney shaking her head, but.
You don't find Richard's secret Instagram. We got it somewhere.
No, it's not there. All right. Yeah, I just put my email in the chat. So if people want to link up or do anything else.
Cool.
Like that.
Cool. Thank you.
No problem.
Yeah. I didn't know if you wanted to like do questions or like discussion now, or you just want to drop your email and that's it. But
No. I'm happy to do that. I don't have anything to do. I'll go eat later. So, so yeah, questions, anybody.
Sorry, yeah, I had a question.
Oh, go ahead.
First of all, that was dope. I really liked hearing all the cool things that you were putting down. It's I think for a lot of us, it's like-minded thinking, which I thought was really cool. Mm-hmm. So I had a question though. So you're talking about how chords are basically going in intervallic steps, right? So like mm-hmm. thirds and sixths and stuff. And I know you can invert them and they're basically the same. So that example that you had a couple of these like that I had a question about in terms of perspective, really.
Okay, which
so one? Like well any of them, but I'll start with like Everybody Loves the Sunshine, like that one.
Okay, let me just put this up. I'm not gonna do the There we go. Hopefully we can all see this. So everybody loves it. Yeah, this one. What's up?
Yeah, I thought it was cool that you went from like one sharp.
Roy Ayers.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, sorry. Roy Ayers, right. But you did the analysis on this, right?
Yeah.
So I thought it was cool that you went from one sharp six to seven because it's the idea that you're pulling from like this mirror, which I thought was really cool. I never thought of something like that before. I've always thought of something
Oh, sorry. I was just going to say.
No. They call it what? What do they call it?
Modal mixture.
Modal mixture. I got
to
remember
when
that
you're
one.
Able to, if you're in a key, where you're in a modality. So if you're in uh-huh. like C major and you, instead of going to the four in C major, you go to the four in C minor and you just kind of like switch the mode. So if I'm in the key of C major. So instead of going one to four, I could go one to minor four.
So yeah.
It just gives me a little bit more instead of those seven chords. We can start to think about even more, not just even tonicizing those.
Yeah, my question was on that though, in terms of perspective. It seems as though like you mentioned modality, which I thought was really cool because you're pulling from like McCoy Tyner kind of stuff, like, you know, like Pasha dance or something where things are sus and you're moving it around. So what I thought was cool was the idea that you had the D sharp in the middle, because what it looks like is that even if it's just displacing the root movement, like how you talked about with ah yeah, it's kind of like you did that whole major third thing where, or not you, Roy Ayers did, but it's like it's a 5/5/5 in the sense that you have like this, you know, sus deal going from F sharp, but it's, you know, it's moving to another five, or it's of a five, which would be B, but you're using the major third of that. But because it's sus, it's kind of like, you know, just a tonality thing, which goes to another five, which would be E, right? And that kind of gives you this cool five. But I feel like, is that a, like a perspective thing, or is that like, is that what's happening? Like, how do you know when to use either or kind of stuff? You know what I'm saying? Like, how do you switch it on between, because you, also the, I mean, the question B, I'll let you answer that question first. There's like a B question, but yeah, sorry.
No, that's a good question. So a lot of this is about perspective. It's not just like necessarily everything is going to be the right answer every single time. There are probably multiple right answers to this. Assignment I gave my students a couple of weeks ago, I gave them a few pieces, a couple from this talk and like some movie scores. The score to, not, I can't remember. Oh. So if you've seen the movie Tenet, if you, or at least listen to the soundtrack, there's a song on there called Posterity. It's the first song you hear in the actual trailer. Let me just make sure I'm not playing it. Yeah. So having them analyze a progression that can be analyzed in multiple keys, where like I'm telling them there's no right, no one right answer. So with this sort of progression, you said, okay, the F sharp, if we think about the trajectory of it being F sharp minor to the E minor, and hearing that sort of circle progression, or if you hear it in that sort of way, Terrence Blanchard does that a lot. A lot of these sort of circle progressions. He does a lot of scores for Spike Lee movies, but yeah, my problem with calling it that, at least from my perspective, is that there's no B in that chord. So with the absence of the B, for me, it would kind of change things for me as far as analyzing that chord like that. So when we get to that D sharp sus 4 chord, to me, it doesn't sound like that chord actually has B being like a chord tone as part of that. Because the first chord we get is this. And then after that, we get that D sharp sounds more like a root to me. And that's something I do. Like I try to arpeggiate through the chord. Or I don't know why I put a G sharp at the bottom.
So it's not a leading tone in any kind of way.
I don't hear it as a leading tone, but you could possibly do it like that. Just like I showed in the Summer Walker. If you want to analyze it in that way, it's possible to do that. It's just the function of that D sharp chord, given the fact that you have no B and you have a major seven, which would be the A sharp if that was a B chord, takes me out of the frame of mind of saying, okay, this is probably something that's tonicizing E, just from the fact that the B is absent and the major seven is present. So that thing that I'm saying, that if we were looking at it in the key of B major, that kind of takes me out of the frame of mind. But if you wanted to see that as like a chord that's tonicized in E, I would encourage you to play through that, because that's exactly what I do. Oh, sorry. It just sounds like three distinct chords, because that's another thing that happens in your soul. Like if I wanted to, what I could do is pick something like a pentatonic scale. What I can do is harmonize every one of those notes with a minor seven chord, just like he does here. I could think of it as minor seven chords, even if I do sus fours or anything like that. So I take this, and what I can do is, and yeah, I can just put those chords. Yeah, and I'm putting all those in root position, but all all I'm doing is just moving stepwise through that scale. I could do the same thing with an actual like major scale if I did. And I could just move through that. And I'm not thinking necessarily functionally yet, or really at all. You don't have to think of it that way. But yeah, that D sharp chord, I can't hear that as a B, like a five of that. Mm-hmm. It sounds more like it's just borrowed from the actual F sharp major.
So cool. Very interesting. Okay. Okay. So then the B side question of that was, I know that you're coming at this from, am I wrong to think that it's a classical perspective?
You said mine, a classical perspective?
Yeah. Like,
informed by that, yes.
Yeah, right. Yeah, yes, exactly right. Informed by a classical perspective, my bad. And then when you're talking about how you don't know, or you're it's hard to classify something as like, I guess contemporary or alternative R&B versus neo soul. Yeah. Is it like, do you think there's some kind of lineage or link between the two with some other genre that like it seems like all of these are possible, you know, like, how do you, I'm sure you've probably taught that in your class. So how would you speak to something like that link or that lineage or genetics, metaphorically speaking?
Sampling. Yeah. That's probably one of the biggest things, but that's something we don't ever talk about. I talked about that a little bit with Jay Dilla, but I didn't get into it that much. The idea of people taking these older tracks and basically reappropriating them for something newer. Like one of the songs that I looked at, sorry, I can't remember which one.
A JD7.
Oh, there it is. This song. Oh, this song is sampled in, what's the name of that? Benita Applebaum, the Tribe Called Quest.
Yeah.
So this is a way for them to take something from 1977 and put it in, you know, the 90s. And then there's this link between rap and R&B and rap and neo soul. Robert Glasper is a prime example of that, because what he's able to do is kind of to bridge this tradition with soul and a lot of jazz and things like that. And then he has hip hop artists. He's part of a group, August Green, with Common and him, and I can't remember the other person. So yeah, like looking at how people actually like pull from the traditions, not just saying, okay, did I hear something in this period? Did I hear it in this time period? Did I hear it in this one? A lot of times there's a dialogue. Sampling to me is a dialogue between generations. We think of it as like this person just samples something that like Kanye West. I've heard people say Kanye West is not a musician, or you know, Pharrell is not a musician because of what they do with the sampling. But to me, that's something that again bridges that sort of imaginary divide to me between generations, because a lot of times you see people, like I've heard older generations sometimes say, well, those young people, you know, they're doing this. And it's like when Marcella said this in an interview, he said the youth are just young version of old people. So this idea, it's a simple saying, but it's just, you know, we're all going to be doing something different. If we did the exact same thing all the time, it's going to be a very boring society. But yeah, this I would say, like, look at how they're actually like communicating with each other, not explicitly necessarily, but through those borrowings, through those samplings, through maybe someone bringing on an older artist on the track. Tyler, the Creator, had Boyz II Men and somebody else, Charlie Wilson, at the performance and at the Grammys last year. So yeah, these, and you hear a lot of his progressions. He kind of does the same stuff, Tyler, the Creator. So yeah, I would look at it that way.
Oh, thank you. I have plenty more, but it's like, I feel like I'm going to take up a lot of time. So that's I'll leave it to Shohei.
No problem. I see some hand up, but I don't see a name. Sorry.
Hi, it's me, if it's all right to ask a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Thanks so much for the talk. This has been so great. I've been trying to also kind of expand the scope of the music that I talk about in my theory classroom, like mm-hmm. starting at the fundamentals level. Okay. I'm also at a college, so it's been really cool to see how you're tying all these things together. I was curious if, this was pretty, you know, analysis, theory heavy and stuff. I'm curious if you've also taken similar steps to like modify like aural skills type curriculum, or like, yeah, how are you approaching that skill stuff differently too with this kind of perspective?
Okay, yeah, definitely in the oral skills classroom. A lot of times, even when we look at traditional theory, we always look at it as just written theory. And then there's another class called oral skills. And to me, they're one and the same. We play the examples for them. We talk about these things. We talk about what they're hearing. Hopefully analysis will inform performance, but it'll also inform our perspective of a piece. That doesn't mean that analyzing this music is going to make it more meaningful. That's not saying that. And I think we tend to do that with music theory. We kind of put it up on this pedestal to say, okay, when we're able to, you know, analyze this and write it down and do these things, we kind of legitimize it by doing that, by putting it in the academy, by putting it in the textbook, things like that. And that's a good thing. We want to be able to like explore these things in the written tradition. I will always teach written music. I will always teach analysis. But a lot of what I try to advocate for is students using these things in more practical matters. So being in the oral skills class, one thing, like I said, I kind of went over this at the beginning of the talk, but the idea of like setting up a key, that's one quick example that we're talking about. The idea of saying, okay, we're in the key of, actually, you give me a key.
A flat.
So I'm pretty sure you do that when you do oral skills, you just set that up. But why not give them a progression that instead of giving them that progression, just playing other tones in there to kind of get them to get a different perspective. Because every single, that's again my problem when I started, is that I was listening for everything to be triadic, no missing notes, stuff like that. I was always listening for that. And the idea that I could play a chord like this and just have that sit there like that and then still be able to putting that there. So one, just immediate exposure to this stuff, not saying, okay, we got to creep this into the curriculum, you know, in a couple months or something like that. The Janet Jackson one, let me put that up here. Yeah, this 1-4-5, we're teaching 1-4-5. Why not use an example like this? It's exactly what you want the students to understand if you're teaching 1-4-5, but to me, that sort of, that wasn't good voice leading, but whatever. So that sort of thing, adding in other tones in there, it still sounds like one. Does that. So putting it in front of the students first and foremost, letting them have a sort of perspective over this and not saying, okay, we're looking for things with clean triads. These triads that aren't that are unaffected by upper extensions or anything else like that. And I look at the last thing I'll say about that is I look at a lot of church musicians, particularly in the black church, and most of them cannot read music. But the stuff that they play is extremely chromatic. I've always said it's the most complex tonal music I've ever heard. What happens in black gospel, in particular contemporary black gospel. What I play that example right here is nothing compared to some of the stuff you might hear in the Ty Tribbett recording or anything else like that. But this idea that if you have, this idea that something that is highly chromatic still can't be understood, it still can't be learned. And allow students to kind of intuit what's going on with that. And if you're trying to find examples of things, I would say not just turn the radio, but there are a wealth of resources available. I'll be happy to point you in the right direction. A lot of this stuff isn't written down. All of these things I had to transcribe. But one thing that I've done and the thing that's kind of expanded my ear is just looking at and listening to different musics. So the Insecure soundtracks. There's four of them that'll give you a head start on a lot of this stuff. The Insecure is a TV show, just in case. But yeah, that idea of just trying to explore different musics, the NPR Tiny Desk playlist, there's a lot of music that I don't necessarily listen to, like Chris Teal. If he comes up, I might not, you know, listen to his music all the time, but I've listened to that performance and I went ahead and looked at, listened to his other pieces. So yeah, for me, a lot of this was just going through and analyzing, not on paper, just listening to it. And the more and more students hear a sharp 11 chord, the more and more they'll recognize it. It's not just like we have to sit there for a whole semester and then stress the importance of the sharp 11 or 5 going to 1. If you hear it a lot, just like a baby hears people talk and they start to repeat it, it's going to be part of the lexicon before you know it.
It's so great to hear you say this. And it's so validating also to hear you say this, because I've been, trying to just introduce sounds to my students, and some of them gravitate towards wanting to like ask more questions about it, rather than, just me sticking to like the Western tonal stuff. And it's been really fun to do that way. Like the students get really excited because like they hear things that they recognize from other places and stuff. And anyway, so it's so validating to hear you say this.
Yeah, I've seen that in my own courses this semester, at least with my freshmen, because this is, again, something I'm slowly trying to adapt myself to, and not slowly on purpose, but just trying to make sure I'm doing it in a way where it's not ill-conceived, or it's not something I'm just doing just to say I put in an example like this, but really making for a meaningful experience. But I've noticed in my own classes where I've had the same response, where I get lively discussions in a freshman theory class. Like students, I'll say, hey, out of 10 students, I'll say, who wants to, I like to put up their homework I like to put up my students' homework on the screen so all of them can share the screen and see me like going over one of their assignments. And you would think students would be scared to do that, but I would get half of them to raise their hands immediately after I say, hey, who wants to go over something? And we have actual, like I said, discussions about things. And it's halfway weird to me, because normally students, I would expect them to hate that stuff, to sit there and talk about theory and everything else like that. But yeah, if you make it more relevant to them, their experiences, I'm lucky to teach in the HBCU and to teach at my alma mater, and to teach a group of students who share like the same cultural background. But that doesn't mean that I won't play other types of music. There's a lot to talk about in salsa. Sometimes I play Mark Anthony when they're coming into the room. There's a lot of other genres out there, Caribbean cultures. There's a lot of Asian American musics, Asian musics, East Asian musics, Middle Eastern musics. It's a lot of things out there that we can talk about. I'm just talking about R&B, neo soul, because I like it. But I'm glad you're at least having success with that. I see another hand. Amari, is it?
Yeah, that's me.
Yeah, how are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm excellent.
Good. I don't really have a question. I just want to thank you, because as like a composer and instrumentalist who came up like in the classical world, but also a church musician, like I would play stuff at church, but I didn't like know how to classify it. And I think like my training in school and in college made me start to sort of discount like the musicianship of the Black church. And so things like this really affirm like me as a person, and how you were talking about like the Black church has some of the finest musicians that are just doing things because it's like in them and it's innate. And so I think that like conversations like these are really important. We need to see more of Richard. I know you don't have an online presence, but like we need a YouTube channel or like a podcast or something, because like more people need to hear this and be affirmed and know that like their existence is like okay just the way that it is.
Thanks. Yeah, I don't know about the social media thing, but you know, I feel I've gotten this far without it. I grew up around, I will say this, if you told me 15 years ago, I was graduating from high school. If you told me then that people like social media would have been a thing now, I would have thought it would have been a joke. Like I remember Facebook was open to students when I became a senior in high school. That was 2006. And I remember everybody posting pictures talking about this and that and all this stuff. And I'm like, okay, this is going to die down. Nobody's going to be posting every single picture in their phone on the internet. And to see what it is today is just, it's still strange to me. I don't think it's a bad thing. I think it's a wonderful tool to be able to connect with people and everything else like that. I just haven't been able to get there yet. But to your point about being able to like experience that stuff within our own culture, being able to not only just analyze it, but to know our music is valid. It is something that kind of is pervasive within a lot of communities, not just outside of the Black community, but within our own. There was the CEO of NAFME, as some of you probably remember him talking about how Blacks and Latinos aren't good at theory and they don't have good keyboard skills. And this was, again, this I think this was 2015 or 2016, but he said this out loud in a meeting, and what was worse is that he got mad when he got checked on it. And the thing is, it's not just that's like being a bad part. Yes, that's a bad thing. Get him out of there, because he's the head of the National Association for Music Educators. Well, it was 5 years ago. But the more sinister element of it to me is that when those communities that are being targeted in that sort of way, when they start to believe that stuff, I've had my own students, I've had people that I went to Howard with, like, they looked at me as a theory guy. Oh, he's good at theory. That's a special thing. Like, I shouldn't have been an anomaly. And it wasn't because other people were dumb. Like I said, I went to school with a lot of great musicians, very intelligent people. But theory was this thing that was like, unless you just immediately understood it, it was like almost off limits to you. And if you immediately understood it, it was this thing that we kind of look at as like almost like an elite sort of thing. If you understand it because it's classical music and high art, then everything else is going to fall in line with that. But I will say, yes, we're going to keep trying to make strides to analyze other musics, to apply theoretical principles to these things. But at the end of the day, if you don't analyze it, it still sounds good. Like, I'm a theorist, yes, but sometimes I just want to cool out and not have to think about it in that sort of way. But it is a good endeavor. It is something that's fun for me to do. But yeah, nobody's at Afropunk with some staff paper. You just are enjoying the actual like presentation of whatever art forms there are. So yeah, I don't know if I saw another hand. It says Thomas Francis.
Yes, sorry, couple of more questions, just definitions, because you're very well informed, so I just want to make sure I got some of these definitions down. So let's say I'm in one major. If you see like flat six, flat seven, one, that kind of progression, like Kiss from a Rose or something by Seal, right? What's that one from the original Spider-Man movie? Doesn't matter. Anyway, what function is flat six and what function is flat seven? Like if you're doing like major to major.
I mean, one, they could just exist as that. If you're in the key of, or... So if you did something like a... So you put that at the very end. I did that with Star Spangled Banner, but if you put that progression...
Sorry, I'm Canadian, so I just, you know.
Oh, okay, cool.
Toronto, baby. I'm like, oh, cool.
I don't know the Canadian anthem. I'm sorry.
It's all good. It's all good, man.
But yeah, if we have that progression, we normally expect 1-4-5-1. But instead of, or even if we extend that, what you can do instead is put that flat six. It almost replaces the function of 4-5-1, because that flat six and the flat seven would be the lower third in both the four and the five chords. So instead of getting, oh, I'm sorry, no. You just, and you can just end it like that. Go ahead.
So sorry, you're saying, so flat six is like four or subdominant functions, flat seven is like the dominant function, and then
I won't
one
say
is one
necessarily episode. Like a strong case for that, like it's definitely a dominant function, anything else like that, but it's more so like filling that in with those chord tones, because normally from five you want 6-7-1 in the major, and then what you're doing is just replacing that with what you would get in the parallel minor key. If you were in G minor,
right, mixing tonalities, right?
Yeah, that's where that flat six and the flat seven come from. So that's ways composers kind of start to do that.
Okay. That's cool. Thank you.
No problem. Anyone else? Sterling. Hi, Sterling.
Hello. This is a great lecture, by the way. So thank you so much for like just sharing all of this information. But I had a question about kind of like the style, the patterns like I see in neo soul and like certain genres of music. So kind of like it with like trap music, it's kind of like one sharp, that type of thing. And then in neo soul, like some of like my friends, like the jazz instrumentalists, they'll say like, oh, neo soul is just like a bunch of 7 chords and just go up a third, like any direction, like kind of thing. Yeah. And that's kind of like the pattern for that. But it's not necessarily the case, but like, why do you think maybe a neo soul or chill hop, lo-fi, I don't know, those type of genres, they kind of go in that pattern. It's not just like within a key, but it's that definitely kind of like that third, minor third type of thing. Yeah. Is it because it's like from the borrowed?
I think that's a big part of it, is that it allows you to borrow a lot more. It allows you to manipulate the tonal structures in which you're like playing with. So if you're in the key of like E flat minor, and then you want to go thirds based on that, you can go, and you can go down a minor third. You can do something like that. And what it does is not only does it allow you to borrow from a lot more things, but it allows you to stay away from what I would think of is the thing that kind of like brings you back to tonic, which is 5-1. And the avoidance of 5-1, I think that's one of the key points of it, is like trying to avoid that relationship between 1-5 and 1, because there's a certain sense of finality that's attached to a 5-1. So if I do 5-1, yeah, it sounds really final no matter what I do. And a lot of times, if they're gonna do like a 5-1 relationship or something like that, they will take away the root so it doesn't sound as strong. And if they do anything else outside of that, then they give it that third bass motion. So like example in E flat minor, if I go 1 E flat to C flat, so I took that from the Janae Aiko example. So yeah, there's no 5 chord in there. So those chords, no one's going to listen to that and say, man, that sounds like Alban Berg or Schoenberg or something like that. It sounds very much tonal. It sounds very tonal, but at the same time, it's that third bass motion, like I said, it allows you to kind of manipulate those structures in a way that, like I said, for me, when I listen to it, it sounds like I'm never like fully grounded, but it's in a comfortable way. Yeah, so that's something that I, kind of like play around with when I'm doing that. Yes, the idea of upper extension, sevenths, things like that. And this is the last thing I'll say to that question. When you add upper extensions in there, not just dealing with like a triad that you borrow, when you add upper extensions, now you have more tension. And not only do you have tension in the chord, you have tension that's borrowed from another key. So you already are dealing with a chord that doesn't fit. So if I go from like C sharp to A sharp, that's supposed to be like that. But if I make that first chord minor, C sharp to A sharp minor, what I'm doing is borrowing the 6 from the major. But what I can do more to just emphasize this relationship will kind of make it feel with more tension, make it a 7 chord, or make it a 9 chord. So you get that sort of sound. So the more upper extensions you add to something, you get those, and you get that sort of sound. So like I said, I don't want to say stay away from 5-1, but that is a good way to go to try to start building these things, is to add thirds above this bass, and make that 11 chord, make that 13 chord, make that 9 chord. And then when you go to something that's a third away and you add those upper tones and it's a different key and it doesn't belong in the key, now you have upper tones there that don't fit, and you also have tension notes that don't fit, but it still sounds good, because there's a certain familiarity there between 1 and minor 1. That's why I think composers exploit this, that third relationship that doesn't necessarily fit. Robert Glasper does this. I talked about in the Photograph soundtrack, because if you think about it, I'll just put it up here on a blank page. So if we think about like C, well, that's an X, I'm sorry. So C going to A flat major. What's the thing there that kind of keeps it grounded? The thing, if you're in the key of C, C is what? It's the strongest note in the chord, in the key. It's like the sun in the solar system. Everything revolves around that. Tonality works that way. Tonality is like musical gravity. Everything is gonna revolve around this thing, but ultimately there's a center. So C is the center. And then after that, C is the foundation of the chord. But then when you move to a flat six, you keep the same mode, which is a major chord. But what happens is when you go down the third, you're not supposed to hear the same type of key. So if I were in the key of C, I went down the third, I'm supposed to hear a minor triad. But now I hear a major one. And then on top of that, I hear one that contains C in it. So it kind of gives you this otherworldly sound. And that's why this sort of progression is, I've shown students like from cartoons, they will use this to show like love scenes, because it's like two people who are distantly related. That's not, you know, coming together that strongly. But at the same time, there's something that connects them. It's the attraction that connects them, but it might not be okay there like together or something like that. So like a lot of times when characters meet for the first time in these things, I don't have them at the ready right now, they'll use one to flat six to show that like romance or something like that, because the foundation of the C chord became the identity of the A flat chord, and you kept both of them major, so that there's something there with that. So yeah, if you have a chance, listen to the Photograph soundtrack, Robert Glasper.
Okay, thank you. I will definitely check that out.
No problem. Anyone else? Okay, cool. Again, thank you to everybody that showed up. Like I said, I did not expect this many people to see the words music theory and to say, let me go to that. So that's a good thing. That means the field is changing, at least people's perception of it. It's always been sort of this walled off garden, been gate kept for years, but I think it'll be good for, you know, people to get into it. Some of you probably heard about the dust up within the music theory world. I don't even know how theory made it into the New York Times, but it did, which is a good and bad thing somewhat. But yeah, the guy basically came out and said all this stuff was going on and we need to change it. And then some people made a stupid response to it. One was more forceful than anybody else. And now he's mad because people are trying to cancel him. But it's weird to me that he did this in the summer. I'm like, this was your day off. And he still managed to mess up. It kind of reminds me of Friday when Smokey asked, he told Craig, like, how you get fired on your day off? So he's like, it was a summer. It was a pandemic. You could have just chilled out. But he decided to make a point to kind of say something. So that was weird to me. But it's good people really push back on him. I don't know what's going to happen to him, but I'm not thinking about it. So, yeah, like I said, thank you for coming out to this. Hopefully, more sessions people will come to and everything else like that. Oh, let me put one other thing on this screen. So you don't have to do this, but just for our organization, the ISBM, any donations will be great. If you scan this on your screen, it'll take you straight to the donation screen for ISBM. I'll also put this in the chat. You can also just do this. So anyway, I don't know if I can do that. Yeah, so anyway, thank you, and hope to see y'all again.
Yeah, thanks everyone for coming.
All right, thank you.
Take a moment to scan that before I end the meeting. I said, no, I'm just giving people a moment to stand there before I end the meeting.
Oh, okay, cool.
All right.